All right, Genesis chapter 9. Let's go back over here. Let's look at verse number 1. The Bible says, "And God blessed Noah and his sons and said unto them, Be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth." Of course, I went over this quite a bit last week, so I'm not going to re-preach that of God's blessing on Noah. It says he blessed him, and then he says, go be fruitful, multiply. This is what I want you to do. I want you to bring forth seed. I want you to have a lot of children. I want you to populate this earth. And we went over that quite a bit in depth last week. Verse number 2 says, "And the fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth and upon every fowl of the air, upon all that moveth upon the earth and upon all the fishes of the sea. Into your hand are they delivered." So God's saying, okay, now I'm going to put the fear of people into animals, which is obvious today. You see that. I mean, as cities grow up and are built in different places, they start off rural. The more people move into a place, the more the animals move out, right? I mean, even the animals that are kind of used to people being around, like a bird, I mean, if you walk up on a bird, they're going to fly away from you because they're scared of you. They have the fear of people as instilled into these animals. And God has done that for a reason, because God has given us dominion over the earth and over all the beasts of the earth. They're ours to do with as we see fit. God has given those animals unto us. And this is, of course, where you'll have the just sick people of the world that are just twisted in their head because they don't have God and they don't know the Bible and they don't know the truth, who will elevate the status of an animal or of a beast to be that of a human being. You have to treat animals as if they're people. And it's disgusting, and it makes me sick, you know, when you see these lawsuits and you see all this stuff where people have elevated the status of an animal. And one place I see it just over and over again, it seems like in the news, in the new local newspaper or whatever, is these canine police dogs, right? It's like, okay, I understand why they use a dog as a tool, as an instrument in the work that they do. It makes sense. It's useful for them to sniff out the drugs or whatever, and to use an animal to do certain things, even just to take down a person or, you know, a violent person. If you don't want to get hurt, send a dog into them. Sure, that makes more sense, that if anyone's going to get hurt, hey, maybe they should hurt the dog before they're going to hurt the person, right? But then they take it to the point to where, like, if they release a dog on you and you kill that dog, they'll, like, bring police murder charges against you for killing an animal. And that's just ridiculous. That's wicked. That's wrong to put a beast or an animal on the same level as a human being. And they'll have all these services. They'll have all these big funeral processions and stuff for these animals. It's like, look, that could be dinner. And you're going to have this whole to-do over an animal? Now, look, we have dogs. We have animals. You know, we love our animals. We treat them well, but they sleep in the garage. They have their place. We feed them. We give them water. We take care of them. We play with them and, you know, do all kinds of stuff. But I'll tell you what, they're there for our benefit. We are not here for their benefit. They are our property. We purchase them. They belong to us. And if I decide to have a lab steak tomorrow for dinner, there's nothing wrong with that. Because they're not, now I'm not going to do that. I don't think they'd probably taste very good, but it doesn't matter. Look at verse number number 3. And this is how we know it. Verse number 3 says, "Every moving thing that liveth shall be meat for you." Meat just means food. You could use that for your food. Everything. "Everything that liveth shall be meat for you, even as the green herb have I given you all things." Just like you can eat the green herbs, just like you can eat the plants and the vegetables and everything else. Hey, I've given you everything that liveth, that moves. I mean, just everything. And we see here, again, I kind of covered this last week, but zero dietary restriction is given to Moses, except for what we're going to see in the next couple of verses. But as far as the types of animals, you know, clean beast versus unclean beast, hey, anything that lives and moves, go ahead and use it for food. And if we could take something and kill it and use it for food, should we be really that concerned like overly concerned about their life? I mean, we're going to kill it and eat it. Now, are you going to kill and eat another person? Of course not. That's grotesque and sick and perverted and twisted, because human life has value. Human life has a lot of value, way above that of the beasts of the earth. But you see, when people don't have God, when they don't know the truth, when they don't believe the Bible, they come with all kinds of weird beliefs, and you know, and that's what happens. You know, that is the road to reprobation. Turn, if you would, to Romans chapter 1 really quick. It's a real familiar passage, but in Romans chapter 1, we see the path that people get started on when they become rejected by God, and it has to do with them placing animals above or equal to God. Think about it. Putting animals at the same level of human beings is bad enough, but when you actually elevate an animal to the status of a god, you're just not right in the head. You're really not. I mean, the Hindus and these other religions will, like, they have their sacred cow. I mean, we talk about sacred cows these days, and people just use it as, you know, as a figure of speech. But it's derived from reality of a religion of people who really literally think that cows are sacred beasts and you shouldn't kill them and eat them or anything like that, because they're like godlike creatures. And that's ridiculous. But Romans chapter number 1 says, look at verse number 20. It says, "For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they were without excuse." Basically saying, look, nobody in this planet has an excuse. We can see enough evidence that God exists. We are his creation, but we can see enough to know that God is real. We don't have an excuse. And it says, even his eternal power and Godhead. We don't have an excuse for seeing that and understanding that truth. Verse number 21 says, "Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man and to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things." So this is where they start, where they make these idols, they make this image of a beast, of an animal, and say, this is God. Like Aaron made that golden calf and said, these be your, thy gods. Here's your God. It's this animal. It's this creation of God that he made to be food for you, that he made for you just to be able to kill and eat and have it pass through your body and you're done with it. I mean, you think about that animal for one day, for one meal, and it's gone. And or for multiple meals, however long that animal seems to last you. But when people start to put animals in that level, especially of equal to God, look what it says in verse 24. It says, "Wherefore," that means because of this, "God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves," and goes on and on and on. And I'm not going to get into that tonight. Actually, I am going to get into that a little bit later on, but not that aspect of it. So we see here, you know, there's no dietary restriction, and people who elevate the status of an animal and they say, oh no, you need, and it blows my mind. People say you have to treat animals humanely. Like you have the humane society. You know that word humane, you drop the E, what is that? Human. Basically they say you have to treat animals like humans. The only problem with that is animals aren't humans. Animals have been given to us by God that we have dominion over them. Now, for example, with a human, would it be humane to put a hook into someone's mouth and then to yank on them and to pull them over, you know, and to put them in water so they can't breathe and then chop them up and eat them? No, of course not. That wouldn't be treating a person humanely. But if you do that to a fish, there's nothing wrong with that. It's called survival. It's called living. It's called eating. You could chop off their head and throw them up on the grill and fillet them and eat them. And God's given them to us for that purpose. We don't have to treat animals humanely like humans. We treat them as they are, as animals. And there's nothing wrong with that. And there should be no apologies for that either. And obviously, it's the same thing with, you know, there's a lot of people out there that want to just be vegan. Not just even just vegetarians, but just vegan. Like, I don't even want to have milk because it comes from an animal and all that. You know, you're abusing these animals by getting the milk out. You know, it's so nonsensical. But we see from the Bible very clearly that God said, hey, you can eat any of this stuff that you want. But let's keep reading because there is a restriction. But it's not about which animals you can and can't eat. Look at verse number 4. He says, but flesh with the life thereof, which is the blood thereof, shall ye not eat. So he's saying, you know, basically you can't drink the blood. You can eat the animal, but I don't want you eating the blood. Okay, you're not supposed to eat the blood. And the funny thing is that you'll run into these stupid atheists and people who don't know the Bible that want to try to use the Bible against you. And it's always when you bring up sins, right? Or these days when you bring up homosexuality, because they say, oh, well, you're just a hypocrite because what do you think? Are we, you know, do you wear, you know, garments with different types of material? You know, and all these other arguments they try to come up with, trying to catch you in some hypocrisy. And one of the things that they'll say is, oh, well, do you eat a rare steak? Now, that just magnifies the ignorance and stupidity of the arguments that these people will try to use against you, because not only are they ignorant of the Bible, but they're just plain dumb. If you really think that when you eat a steak that the red juice that comes out is actually blood, you're ignorant. You have no idea what you're talking about. That's not blood that's found within the meat that you're eating when you eat a steak. That's a totally different juice. I know this firsthand from when I kill my elk. I butchered it myself. Is there a lot of blood? Sure, there's a lot of blood. And you bleed it out and you gut it. But when you get to the meat itself is red. Like the meat that I eat, it comes out. It's already red. And as you start to cook it, the redness goes away and it starts to turn brown. Okay, and if it's still kind of red, that was the natural color of that meat. It's not because it's just soaked in blood. That color doesn't go away. That's the color of the meat itself. So as you cook it, it's, you know, there's all these juices, and it, you know, I'm not going to go into all of the chemical things that happen when you're heating up food, but it's retarded to think that red stuff is just blood. I mean, you call it a bloody steak just because it looks red and looks similar to blood, but it's not blood. So he's not saying you can't have a rare steak. He's saying not to drink the blood. And you know what? There are a lot of people out there that do drink the blood. And there's a lot of occultists and satanic worshipers and things like that where they actually think that they gain extra power by drinking blood. And of course, there's all the mythology of vampires and things like that, but it's not just, you know, I'm not saying that vampires are necessarily real, but people that do that type of a thing, they think there is extra powers that they get. And part of the reason they might even get that is from the Bible, because he says in verse 4, but the flesh with the life thereof, which is the blood thereof. The blood contains that life. So there is that power of blood that keeps us alive. And that is where we get our life from, is from the blood, just like we get our life, our eternal life, through the blood of Jesus Christ. The blood that we have in our bodies keeps us alive as well. And it actually literally brings all of the nutrients and everything else that we need for our bodies to live. But they take that and satanically, against God's word, will think that by drinking that they're going to receive some extra powers. And now, regardless of even if that's true or not, God said not to do it. Even if what they're saying is true, like, well, you can get these extra powers, it doesn't matter. God said not to do it, and that's wickedness and sinful and satanic to go and do something like that. Now, most people aren't going to do that anyways, but this is what he's teaching, and this is the restriction that he has placed on eating. Just, okay, you can eat whatever animal you want, but don't eat the blood. Don't drink the blood, is what he's saying. But let's keep going here in verse number 5, because God does place a high value on our blood. And verse number 5 says, and surely your blood of your lives will I require. At the hand of every beast will I require it, and at the hand of man, at the hand of every man's brother will I require the life of man. Whoso sheddeth man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed. For in the image of God made he man. Now God, this is a new law that he's given unto Noah. This was not into effect prior to the flood. Because if you remember, when Cain slew Abel, when he killed his brother, he did not receive the death penalty. And that judgment came from God. It didn't even come from man. God's judgment was not to kill him at that time. He was exiled. He was going to be a nomad. He was going to have a real rough life. But he did not kill him. And then we see, you know, this wickedness just abounding in such a short period of time. And everybody's, you know, just doing evil things and wicked things to each other. And just violence has filled the whole earth. So God decided to do a different way of dealing with that problem by instituting the death penalty. Because it was never God's desire for man to be killed or to be, let me put it this way, to be put to death. You got to be careful when you use that word killed. Because a lot of people try to trap you with that too. They'll say, well, wait a minute, there's a contradiction in the Bible, because in the Ten Commandments it says thou shalt not kill, but then it says that you have to put these people to death. And what they do is they take that definition of the word kill, and what they mean is just by taking another person's life. But when you read it in context of the Bible, the word kill doesn't just mean someone's life is taken by someone else. It's murder, right? You are taking their life, but it's not because of a judgment or carrying out an execution or something like that. That would be justified of someone losing their life and the person being the instrument that does that. Or being in a war or something like that. Killing in the Bible, thou shalt not kill, is not murdering people. And that's the way it's used, and it's clearly, you can get that from the context. So what he's saying here, this isn't a contradiction. He's just passing the law and saying, okay, if someone like Cain, and that's why he says here too, he says, you know, your blood, it's going to be required. So like if someone sheds your blood, he's like, that can't just be forgotten. That needs to be dealt with. There's going to be a requirement that something needs to be done to pay for that. And he says, whether it's at the hand of every beast. So if an animal kills you, that animal is going to be put to death. If a man kills you, even if your brother kills you. And he threw that in there because Cain was the first example of that. Cain killed his brother. It doesn't matter who it is. Anybody that sheds man's blood, he says, by man shall his blood be shed. So he's saying you're going to take that person and a man's going to put him to death or put them to death. And, you know, the animals, that's why, you know, every animal that kills a human being, they need to be put to death. And again, we live in a world today where people don't want to do that anymore. I remember there was some zoo and like some tiger got out and like killed a person. And what you need to do is you need to put that animal to death. That's required because he killed a man. That animal, that beast killed a man. Hey, God requires that animal be put to death. And people say, oh, but he's an animal. He doesn't know anybody. It doesn't matter. God's word says that animal needs to be put to death. It's required of him. The same way that if a person murdered someone else, that person needs to be put to death. But we live in a society today that's backwards, that doesn't care about God's word and says, oh, no, no, that's cruel. Oh, no, we can't put this animal to death because they're endangered. Or we can't put this person to death because they're just, you know, sick. They have a mental illness and they just need some help. No, they need to be put down. That's the way that God prescribed how to deal with this issue. And if we did a lot more of that, then the society in general would be better, and the crime rate would go down if people were being put to death for crimes like murder that God has prescribed. Let's keep reading here. Look at verse number 7. He says, and you, be ye fruitful and multiply, bring forth abundantly in the earth and multiply there. Again, I mean, he's just repeating himself about multiplying and bringing forth seed. Verse number 8, and God spake unto Noah and to his sons with him, saying, and I, behold, I will establish my covenant with you and with your seed after you, and with every living creature that is with you, of the fowl, of the cattle, and of every beast of the earth with you, from all that go out of the ark to every beast of the earth. So God says, I'm going to make a promise to you. I'm going to make a covenant. I'm going to join a covenant with you. And he says, not just going to be with you, it's going to be with every living creature on the earth. I'm going to make this promise. I'm going to make this covenant. It's going to be between me and all of you for all time. Look at verse number 11. He says, and I will establish my covenant with you. Neither shall all flesh be cut off any more by the waters of a flood. Neither shall there any more be a flood to destroy the earth. So God makes his promise and says, I will never flood the earth again. Not going to happen. This event with Noah is a one-time thing. He promises to never do that again. And that's why he made the promise between man and the beast, because everybody got killed. Not just mankind, but all the beasts and everything else except for those that were on the ark. So he says, okay, I will never do this again. You can, if you could rest one thing for sure. Now, it doesn't mean that people won't be destroyed. It doesn't mean there's not going to be other judgments of God. But he said, I'm never going to flood the earth again. That's not going to happen. And he says in verse 12, he gives them a token of that promise. In verse number 12, he says, and God said, this is the token of the covenant which I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for perpetual generations. That's just for generations to come forever and ever and ever. For the perpetual generations, I do set my bow in the clouds. And it shall be for a token of a covenant between me and the earth. So we see here God's promise, and the token that God made this promise is the rainbow. And, you know, it's a pretty cool thing. And every time we see the rainbow, as a big storm comes through, whatever, and you see that rainbow, it's a great opportunity to explain to my children. And me, it's a remembrance. Every time I see a rainbow now these days, I just think like, hey, that's amazing. You know, it's really beautiful. It's cool. You see all those colors in the sky. And it's a reminder that God is not going to flee. I mean, no matter how bad of a storm you're in, and you know, when things seem to be flooding and stuff, well, at least God's not going to flood the whole earth. And we're not going to, you know, the whole world isn't going to be destroyed by a flood, because there's that rainbow God promised. And he's going to see that and he's going to remember. But, you know, I say that every time I see a rainbow, I think about that. And that's true. When I see one in the sky, it used to be a time where you could see rainbow stickers and rainbow things all over the place or anywhere, and it would just be a pleasant thing, because who doesn't like a rainbow, right? It's kids love them, little girls love them. I know my girls love rainbows and all this other stuff. But nowadays we live in such a sick society that I don't want to see the rainbow anymore, because the sodomites have taken and stolen this godly token, this godly symbol of the rainbow, and have perverted it to signify their wickedness and their sin. And it's ridiculous to me. And what's funny is, when I see that, I've thought about this before. You know, I don't know if they're clinging to that, thinking like, well, God's not, you know, even though we're such wicked, vile reprobates, God's not going to destroy us with the flood because we've got this rainbow. You know, I know that's not really what they're thinking, but I'm thinking like, you are clinging to a false hope, because he's going to rain fire and brimstone down on you like he did in Sodom and Gomorrah. Don't cling to that rainbow. That rainbow is just the promise of not bringing a flood upon you. But he'll still destroy you with fire, and you're going to burn in hell with the fire of God, with the wrath of God. But it's so sick that they're so twisted that they could take literally. I mean, this is where the rainbow comes from. And I don't care what kind of science you want to put behind it. This token came from God. And you could explain away why you see the things that you do, and that's fine. And I don't care. I don't have a problem with that. But I know that it originated. It came from God for a token for us to know. And to know about him, and to know that he will never destroy this earth with a flood again. Let's keep reading here, because we're going to get a little bit more into this whole reprobate thing in a little bit. And verse number 14, I think we left off on 13, verse 14. And it shall come to pass, when I bring a cloud over the earth, that the bow shall be seen in the cloud, and I will remember my covenant, which is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the water shall no more become a flood to destroy all flesh. And the bow shall be in the cloud, and I will look upon it, that I may remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is upon the earth. And God said unto Noah, this is the token of the covenant which I have established between me and all flesh that is upon the earth. He just reiterates everything. Just this, you know, you can trust that I'm not going to flood the earth again. This is a covenant. This is a promise. This is a surety. It's everlasting between me and everyone on the earth. Verse number 18. And the sons of Noah that went forth of the ark were Shem and Ham and Japheth. And Ham is the father of Canaan. Now, we're going to get to this in just a second here, because it's an important verse. And when you read things in the Bible, sometimes you might think, and on your first reading of this, you'd be like, well, that's kind of weird. You know, it tells us about Noah's sons, you know, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Okay, I could understand that. But then he says, and Ham is the father of Canaan. But why does it mention that right there? Because it's going to be important in a few more verses. But he just throws that in there. He doesn't tell us about, you know, Shem's or Japheth's children at all. And he doesn't tell us about Ham's other children. He just says, Ham's the father of Canaan. Just you need to know this. Okay. Let's keep reading here. Verse number 19 says, these are the three sons of Noah, and of them was the whole earth overspread. So again, I mean, another clear verse that everyone in the earth was killed by the flood, because he's saying by these three people, by Noah's sons, everybody in the entire world is going to come from them, from this family, from Noah's family, from his three sons. Every person in the whole earth could be traced back to those people that's alive on the earth today. But let's keep reading here, verse number 20, because we're going to get to why that's important about Ham and Canaan. Verse number 20, and Noah began to be an husbandman, and he planted a vineyard. And he drank of the wine and was drunken, and he was uncovered within his tent. So after the flood, Noah plants a vineyard. You know, he's got his animals, he grows his vineyard, and he makes some wine, and he gets drunk. Now, I've preached on this in the past on alcohol, but this, I mean, we need to take these stories seriously and how important this is. We can learn from them about the dangers of drinking alcohol and especially getting drunk more than anything. Noah was passed out. He drank enough to get drunk and be passed out and to not know what's going on. When you can get yourself in the position of having no idea what's going on around you and about you, anything can happen to you. And there is nothing you can do about it. And this is the position that Noah found himself in. And I'll tell you what, especially to the ladies, don't ever allow yourself to get into this type of situation. And even to men. And look, even if you're around your family, don't think, well, I'm not going out to the bar because who knows who I'll meet out there, but I'm just going to drink and get drunk with my family at my family function. Don't do it. Noah had no one else in the entire world around but his own family. And let's keep reading. We're going to see what happens here. Verse number 21. It says, when he drunk, so he got drunk and he was naked in his tent. That's what he means. He was uncovered. So he's naked in his tent because he got drunk, he got naked, and he passes out. Verse number 22, and Ham, now look at this again, the father of Canaan. So again, it throws it in there that Ham's the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father and told his two brethren without. And Shem and Japheth took a garment and laid it upon both their shoulders and went backward and covered the nakedness of their father. And their faces were backward, and they saw not their father's nakedness. And Noah awoke from his wine and knew his younger son had done unto him. Now, before I go any further in explaining this story, I want to first, let's jump forward a little bit. Keep your finger here. We're going to be back here. We're going to see some other references to Canaan and the inhabitants of Canaan. Because Canaan was a person, right? Canaan was a descendant of Ham. But the descendants of Canaan, you know, they all lived in a certain area, and the land that they lived in basically became known as the land of Canaan, because it was Canaan's land. Like that was his land, and it was known because all of his descendants lived in that land. And this is the land that the children of Israel were going to go and inherit one day after God brings them out of the land of Egypt by the hand of Moses. And so we're going to see a little, some of the characteristics of Canaan. Okay. It's important to understand all this. In Genesis chapter 16, if you want to jump a few chapters ahead, in verse number 3 of Genesis 16, the Bible says, and Sarai, Abram's wife, took Hagar, her maid, the Egyptian, after Abram had dwelt 10 years in the land of Canaan, and gave her to her husband Abram to be his wife. So this is to tell us about the story when, you know, Abram They were kind of at a point where they're doubting God's word, because God had promised that he was going to have a son and that his seed was going to be like the sand of the earth, and all of a sudden he made all these promises to him, and he hadn't had a son. Hadn't had a child, right? Sarai was barren. So notice it says here, and look, none of this is by coincidence. It says, after Abram had dwelt 10 years in the land of Canaan. So he had been in Canaan now for 10 years. He wasn't always in Canaan. He was called out of Paran and called out of his homeland and told to go into Canaan. Now he'd been in Canaan for 10 years. And after those 10 years, that's when Sarai gave him her handmaid to be essentially his concubine, right? So that he could have a child by her. And that was wickedness. That was sin. They shouldn't have done that. That was a lapse in his faith. And I don't think it's a coincidence that he had been in this land around these people for 10 years. Now all of a sudden he's resorting to this method of maybe he could have a son with someone else that's not his wife. Right? It's wickedness. It's sin. But let's keep going here. Look at another example. Genesis 28 verse 1. Genesis 28:1 says, "And Isaac called Jacob and blessed him and charged him and said unto him, Thou shalt not take a wife of the daughters of Canaan." Canaan, the land of Canaan had a whole group of people that were wicked people. And we see here now in Genesis 28, it's gotten to the point to where Isaac's calling Jacob, he says, "I don't want you marrying any of these women from Canaan because they're wicked, they're heathen, they don't trust in the Lord." So that's another example. 1 Chronicles 1:13, here we get some chronicles. We get to see who the descendants of Canaan are. And keep these people in mind because they represent places as well. 1 Chronicles 1:13 says, "And Canaan begat Zidon, his firstborn." You remember the cities of Tyre and Sidon? Sidon comes from this person here, Canaan's descendant of Zidon, his firstborn, and Heth, the Jebusite also, and the Amorite, and the Girgashite, and the Hivite, and the Arkite, and the Sinite, and the Arvidite, and the Zemarite, and the Hamathite. Now, some of those names should sound familiar to you, because over and over again, when God is sending in his people to claim the land of Canaan, these are the heathen people that they're ousting out of the land, right? It's these people, the Jebusite, the Hivite, the Amorite, the Hittite, the Perizzite. This is constantly over and over again brought up to us. Now, turn if you would to Leviticus 18. That's another concept we have to understand here. So that gives you just a little bit of understanding. We see the future, at this point, the future of Canaan and his descendants. They're a wicked people, and they turn to be pretty wicked. And actually, turn if you would to go to Leviticus 20 first. I want to cover this first, and then we'll go to Leviticus 18. They're right next to each other. No big deal. Leviticus 20. Look at verse number 9. We're going to read through this. We read through this recently when I was doing my sermon on the death penalty. But we'll read this for just to get a proper understanding of what's going on here. Verse number 9 says, "For everyone that curseth his father or his mother shall be surely put to death. He hath cursed his father or his mother, his blood shall be upon him. And the man that committeth adultery with another man's wife, even he that committeth adultery with his neighbor's wife, the adulterer and adulteress shall surely be put to death. And the man that lieth with his father's wife hath uncovered his father's nakedness, both of them shall surely be put to death. Their blood shall be upon them. And if a man lie with his daughter-in-law, both of them shall surely be put to death. They have wrought confusion, their blood shall be upon them. If a man also lie with mankind as he lieth with a woman, both of them have committed an abomination, they shall surely be put to death, their blood shall be upon them. Then if a man take a wife and her mother, it is wickedness. They shall be burnt with fire, both he and they, that there be no wickedness among you." Notice how these things are starting to kind of get like worse real fast. It starts with, you know, someone cursing their father. Now, they're all serious sins because they're carrying this death penalty, right? I mean, someone cursing their father and mother, hey, God put the death penalty on it. They need to be put to death. These are all serious sins, but they start getting more weird as you go. Committing adultery, yeah, that's a serious sin. But you can still see that's a natural sin. That's something that happens because we have this lust of the flesh, because men lust after women and women lust after men, and they end up committing adultery, right? And it's wickedness and deserves the death penalty, but you understand where it's coming from. And then it says, someone taking his father's wife, and it's like, what? And then if a man lie with his daughter-in-law, and then a man lying with another man, I mean, you see it. This is just progressively just getting weirder and weirder. And it says, and if a man take a wife and her mother, this is just bizarre. I mean, his mother-in-law and his wife are both like his wives. That he's been intimate with both of them. Verse number 15, and if a man lie with a beast, he shall surely be put to death, and he shall slay the beast. And if a woman approach unto any beast and lie down thereto, thou shalt kill the woman and the beast. They shall surely be put to death. Their blood shall be upon them. I mean, this is just bizarre. This is talking about men with animals. Like, you can't get any more perverted and twisted than that. Like, what else is there? And it goes on. And it says, just jump down to verse 20. I don't want to read all, because there's so much here. Verse 23 says, and ye shall not walk in the manner. I mean, you can just keep on going if you want. You can see all the different sins that he mentions here. But we've gone far enough. Verse 23 says, and ye shall not walk in the manners of the nation which I cast out before you, for they committed all these things, and therefore I abhorred them. All of these sins, and I didn't even read them all by far. I read maybe half of them. All of those things, the land of the Canaanites did. This is the point that they had degenerated to, doing all of this type of wickedness and all of this type of sin. The whole land, he says, they did those things. And that's why I hated them. I abhorred them. That's what the Bible says. This is what happens to Canaan and his descendants. Okay? Now flip back, if you would, to 18. And you say, you know, how did all this happen? Where did it all start? And I believe it all started back in Genesis chapter 9 with Ham in the story we just read, because verse 22 says, and Ham, the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father and told his two brethren without. And Shem and Japheth took a garment and laid it upon their shoulders and went backward and covered the nakedness of their father, and their faces were backward, and they saw not their father's nakedness. So what does this story mean? Because I'll be honest with you, I was confused about this story for a while. I didn't understand, because at first glance I'm thinking, okay, you know, Ham walks into his father and says, hey dad, I want to talk to you about something. And he goes in and he's like, whoa, you know, dad's naked. And he goes out and he tells his brothers, and then his brothers go and, you know, they don't look, and they walk backward and they cover him up, right? This is what I, like this is just how I read it for a real long time. I didn't understand that. It didn't make any sense to me. It's because, like, we see this great curse from Noah after he wakes up, right? Look at verse number 25 of Genesis 9. I know I'm kind of not having you in the right place. Keep your finger in Leviticus and in Genesis 9, so we go back and forth. Genesis 9, 25 says, and he said, cursed be Canaan, a servant of servants shall he be unto his brethren. And he said, blessed be the Lord God of Shem, and Canaan shall be his servant. God shall enlarge Japheth, and he shall dwell in the tents of Shem, and Canaan shall be his servant. So Noah curses Ham's child, Ham's descendant, Canaan. He makes this pretty severe curse. I mean, a servant of servants. Why do you think Noah would just have such a horrible curse on Ham's son if all he did was just stumble in and just see something? Oh, he shouldn't have seen it, which he couldn't have even helped, right? It would make zero sense. Zero sense. I mean, if you were to walk in on someone, you never know. I mean, you could walk into a restroom somewhere and you could see someone just completely naked or whatever. Like, you are not, that is not a sin for you to just to be thrown into that situation completely unawares. Right? Now, it's a sin if you just keep on, like, feasting your eyes or whatever. You say, whoa, you know, back off. But you get things are presented in front of your eyes that you sometimes have no control over. There would be no point to this cursing. And then we see this great result that came of it. But the answer is found in verse 24. Because what really happens, it says, when he saw his father's nakedness, it wasn't just See, the Bible's very being using language here that anybody can hear, and it's not graphic and doesn't go into detail, okay? Because it's an extremely wicked thing that happened, and the Bible doesn't even want to talk about those things that are done of them in secret, right? It's the Bible is pure, and it can still tell us about events that happen without getting into detail and using these euphemisms to let us know what happened. But the key to really understanding this is found in verse 24, because it says, "And Noah awoke from his wine and knew what his younger son had done unto him." Now, how could Noah wake up from his wine and know that his younger son had done something unto him? Now, do you think it's because he woke up and he was covered? So he's like, "Oh, my son covered me. Like, I'm going to curse him now. I'm going to curse his child because he put a covering on me." No. And because also we see that his younger son isn't even the one that covered him. His brothers covered him. It wasn't Ham that covered Noah. In order for him to wake up and to know that something was done to him, he was violated. Now, I'm going to prove this. Turn back, if you would, to Leviticus chapter number 18. Because this is important. Because a lot of people are like, "No, that's ridiculous. You know, he didn't do that to him. He didn't do that." Yes, he did. We see the result of what happened from Ham's descendants. We see the wickedness that they were into. We see even early on, I mean, with Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, the wickedness would rub off on them, and they didn't want to have their wives at all. Stay away from them. They're wicked. Leviticus 18, I'm going to prove this to you. And I'm going to prove that when it says that he saw the nakedness of his father, that it didn't just mean a visual thing. Okay? Leviticus 18, look at verse number 3. It says, "After the doings of the land of Egypt, wherein ye dwelt, shall ye not do. After the doings of the land of Canaan, whither I bring you, shall ye not do, neither shall ye walk in their ordinances." So again, I mean, we see another reference to Canaan. Verse number 4. And this is important. I mean, we can't just throw these references to Canaan aside, because why is this in here so much? Why does he keep on referencing Canaan? It's in there for a very good reason, to tie everything together for us to understand. Verse number 4, "Ye shall do my judgments and keep mine ordinances to walk therein. I am the Lord your God. Ye shall therefore keep my statutes and my judgments, which if a man do, he shall live in them. I am the Lord. None of you shall approach to any that is near of kin to him to uncover their nakedness. I am the Lord." Now we're going to go through this and we're going to see this concept of people's nakedness, okay? "The nakedness of thy father or the nakedness of thy mother shalt thou not uncover. She is thy mother. Thou shalt not uncover her nakedness." Now, and again, when it's talking about uncovering someone's nakedness, this isn't talking about just, you know, lifting up their shirt or something. It's talking about the act that goes along with taking off, the fornication or adultery. He's saying, you can't do that. He's saying it's wickedness, okay? Verse number 8, we're going to keep reading through this. "The nakedness of thy father's wife shalt thou not uncover. It is thy father's nakedness. The nakedness of thy sister, the daughter of thy father, or the daughter of thy mother, whether she be born at home or born abroad, even their nakedness thou shalt not uncover." And again, there's this weird story of someone who, like, you know, these brothers and sisters that have, like, one of their parents is different and they didn't even know about it, and they meet each other and they, like, fall in love and all this other stuff. And it's like, that's wicked. That's wrong. They shouldn't do that. They shouldn't get married. And some of them, they want to get married. And I think they do, like, in these foreign countries and stuff. I've seen a story of that where it's like they had at least one of the same parents. So they're like half brother and half sister. The Bible says that's not right. You can't do that. But anyways, I don't want to get off on that tangent. Verse number 10, "The nakedness of thy son's daughter or thy daughter's daughter, even their nakedness thou shalt not uncover, for theirs is thine own nakedness. The nakedness of thy father's wife's daughter, begotten of thy father, she is thy sister. Thou shalt not uncover her nakedness. Thou shalt not uncover the nakedness of thy father's sister. She is thy father's near kinswoman. Thou shalt not uncover the nakedness of thy father's sister, of thy mother's sister, for she is thy mother's near kinswoman." And it goes on and on about uncovering people's nakedness and who you can and who you can't, or not who you can, just don't uncover their nakedness, don't uncover their nakedness. But you'll say, okay, but that says to uncover their nakedness, right? But what we see is that Ham saw the nakedness of his father. But I'm going to show you why right here. Look at Leviticus 20, where we just were. And I didn't even read this verse. Verse number 17. I'm going to prove to you now how that reference of seeing his nakedness is the same thing as uncovering his nakedness. Okay? Now, I'll explain why he used the word see, because then his brothers came in, they walked backwards and everything else. It all fits with the story and the way that he's telling it. But look at Leviticus 20:17, because this is the key. It says, and if a man shall take his sister, his father's daughter or his mother's daughter, and see her nakedness, and she see his nakedness, right? So now we're seeing the same thing. They see each other's nakedness, right? It is a wicked thing, and they shall be cut off in the sight of their people. He hath uncovered his sister's nakedness. He shall bear his iniquity. It's equating seeing the nakedness with uncovering the nakedness. Now, of course, uncovering the nakedness isn't just removing the garment. Just like seeing isn't just visibly seeing it. They're performing an act, and the Bible is being tactful about that and using these terminologies to explain it in a way that it's already a not a pleasant subject to talk about with most of these cases, but in a way that anybody can hear. And we're supposed to be able to understand this. So when Ham saw the nakedness of his father, he did more than just see him naked. He violated him. Noah was drunk. He was defenseless. He had no part of it. If Noah was awake, he wouldn't have allowed it to happen. He was vulnerable. He was passed out. He was violated. And then he cursed Canaan. And this was the result of that. And we see how wicked and where it all started from. It all started with that progenitor of Ham. And the wicked, vile reprobate that he was taught unto his generation. I mean, and it makes sense. Like, I don't think his brothers wanted to have anything to do with him after that. They're probably like, get out of here. Go live by yourself. Right, and they were left to live the wicked life that they live, and the Canaanites were a wicked people, and they were destroyed, and they were the ones that were slaughtered. And if you remember, you know, people, a lot of times we have a hard time understanding this too, and again, I had a hard time with this as well, when the Bible recalls this or gives us the stories of Joshua going in and leading the battle, and God telling them, like, you know, the women, the children, everybody needs to be destroyed. God was wiping them out because of their egregious sins. Because of all those things we saw in Leviticus 20 and Leviticus 18 and all those laws, he's basically saying, look, they've done all of these things. Lying with animals, lying with men, lying with, you know, all these different things they're doing. They did it all. They're just perverted and wicked and twisted, and they need to be wiped out. Their judgment is coming upon them. And it all started with that one reprobate at the top of him, and his descendants were all wicked. Now, you may think it's a bit presumptuous to think that all of Canaan's problems stemmed from this incident, but I say, how could it not be traced back to that? We have all of this evidence. I mean, Canaan is referenced all over the place. Noah curses Canaan, and now we can see the proof of what actually happened in this story, because people will try to tell you different things happened there. But I don't, like once I've heard this, and once I saw this, okay, yeah. This makes a lot of sense. This is like the only thing I could see that makes sense, because what else could he have done unto him that he would have known when he woke up? That he would just know. I mean, after being passed out. Look, I've been in that condition before being passed out. I've had people, you know, punch me and do other things and just be oblivious to it. Now, I've never had this happen, thank God. That something like this has never happened, but people have said they've done things, and I don't know. And I didn't even know. I mean, people said, like, they punched me and stuff. I don't know. I've been cut before. I woke up bleeding. No idea. Until later. And then it's like, oh, something happened. Didn't have any clue. But he knew something happened to him when he woke up, and that was his wicked son Ham. But this isn't the only event. If you remember the story of Lot, when the angels were sent and Lot was taken out of the land of Sodom and Gomorrah, and you know the fire and brimstone rained down and God destroyed the whole city. They went and they fled, and they fled to Zoar, and then God destroyed that, and they went out to a cave, and they were just dwelling in a cave. And his daughters were saying, because remember, his wife died, she turned into a pillar of salt. So he's in this cave with his daughters, and they're thinking like, well, God's just destroying the whole earth, because they're living in this cave, and they just saw these cities get destroyed. And foolishly, they're just thinking like, no one's left alive. So like, well, we need to keep seed alive upon the earth. Like, it's our job. We just got to make sure that we could procreate and have children. So what do? They get Lot drunk. Again, this is not just a coincidence. People get violated when they get drunk. It happens. It's a fact. Girls get raped all the time. And in these cases, I mean, we're seeing men getting raped. Because they're drunk, because they're passed out, because they have no clue what's going on, they can't defend themselves. They can't stand up and do what's right because they're in a state. But his daughters, two nights in a row, they get him drunk. It says he doesn't know when they lie down. He doesn't know when they got up. They laid down. They you know, committed that act with them and became pregnant. Now, the children that were a result of that wicked, incestuous event were Ammon and Moab. The Ammonites and the Moabites were a result of that. Now, again, I'm not going to go through all the different passages tonight to see what a great people the Ammonites and the Moabites were. Because they were wicked too. Just like the Edomites, the Ammonites, the Moabites, the Canaanites, the Hivites, the Jebusites, the Perizzites, all these people that God judged all stem back to being coming out of their either reprobate or extremely twisted beginnings. And you know, I've preached on this topic before, and I've actually had someone leave a comment on how, well, I've never heard this before, and you know, these famous theologians, they've never said anything like this before, so you must be wrong. It's like, okay, I don't care if you've never heard this before from the Bible, but judge it based on the evidence that's in the Bible for itself. And you know what? If you don't believe this, I don't care. I'm just preaching the truth. This is what the Bible says. I don't see how you can deny the evidence that's been brought forth already as a result of this. But, you know, there was a time when I hadn't heard this before either. But when I did see it for myself and I saw the scriptures and someone showed that to me, I was like, okay, yeah, it's clear as day. That's what happened. You know, when I look at the evidence, that's what I see. And again, if you want to disagree with that, fine, whatever. But I don't see where you could come up with anything else here, because this is a serious curse. Ham had done something to his father, no doubt about it. He did something. If it wasn't what I'm suggesting, then what was it? What was it that he did to bring about such a curse, and that for that nation to just go into such depraved wickedness that they had nothing else to do, but God just had to wipe them out? So let's finish up the chapter and we're done. Verse number 28 says, "And Noah lived after the flood 350 years, and all the days of Noah were 950 years, and he died." So Noah lived for quite a while after the flood, so 350 years. And just real briefly, I know there's some people who think that you know, when the flood happened, I think I've seen like some Kent Hovind videos, and he has a lot of interesting theories on stuff, and some of them I like and I agree with, and some of them I don't. I don't necessarily think that you know, the earth was necessarily real special to make people live this long. And when the flood happened, now all of a sudden people weren't living as long, because when you start looking at how long people lived after the flood, they still lived quite a long. I mean, Noah lived 350 years, and other people were still living a long time, 500 years, 400 years. And it goes on for a while before it actually gets down to kind of the number we're at today. And, you know, this isn't really that big of a deal. This is just what I believe about that as we're finishing up the chapter is I think that, you know, ever since the sin, people, you know, and that sin was entered into the world, there was more and more chaos and more disorder, and things just end up getting worse and worse and worse and worse and worse in general. And it happens slowly. And then it gets to the point to where, you know, now we've leveled off. But the way God originally made us obviously had changed, and we've settled into where our lifespan is now and has been for quite a while. But let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for this passage and for all the truths that we could learn here, God. You know, this story is not a pleasant one, and there's a few of them in the Bible that are not very pleasant that teach us these things, but we need to know them. It's a harsh truth, and it's a very sobering truth that we should learn. And if there are people listening to this sermon, dear God, that still consume alcohol and get drunk, dear Lord, I pray that you would please just work in their heart specifically and show them how dangerous it is to drink and to get drunk and to pass out, even around your family. I mean, Noah couldn't have expected to have any more safety. There was no one else in the world but his own family, his own children. Yet he still ended up getting violated by his own family. And oftentimes, Lord, we know that that's what happens in many cases where people get violated by members of their own family. And so often it has to do with alcohol and as a result of being passed out or under the influence of being drunk, dear Lord. God, it's so not worth it. You've already commanded us not to do it. That ought to be enough, dear Lord, but I pray that you would please just give us enough sense that we wouldn't be going out and getting drunk and allowing ourselves to be put into these vulnerable situations, dear Lord. I pray that you would please just continue to open up our understanding as we read your words, dear Lord. And give us more wisdom that we can walk worthy of you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.